Hi friends, this is Maria Di Costa and you're watching me on My Goa, My India. And my today's guest is the smart and sassy Roslyn Pereira, who we lovingly know as Auntie Maggie. Roslyn, welcome on my show. It's a pleasure to have you here.
Thanks so much for having me, Maria. The pleasure is all mine and I'm really excited to chat with you.
You know, Roslyn, I've been binge watching Auntie Maggie episodes all over again. And I just felt we needed to add a little bit from some of my favorite episodes to this interview. It would be fun to cut from Maggie to the real you and back again. So friends, let's know a bit more about Roslyn. So Roslyn, tell us something about yourself.
You know, Maria, when I get asked this question, usually I start off about what I do, which is emceeing or the YouTube thing. But I realize that we are more than what we do. So I'm going to attempt to answer your question slightly differently. I think I'm balanced. I'm very content with very little, and that can be a good and a bad thing. I think I'm easygoing, but sometimes I'm high strung depending on the situation. Basically what I'm trying to say is I enjoy being on stage. I love what I do. I love facing the camera or writing, but I also love baking. I love my time off between projects. I love traveling. I love spending time with my friends. I like a good workout. I think what I'm trying to say is that I like to be immersed in whatever it is that I'm doing, you know, so I'm 100% present and I'm loving and enjoying every minute of it. And I want that each and every one of these things is part of my life. So all my eggs are not in the work basket or in the home basket or in the socializing basket. It's kind of spread out and that's the way I like it. One interesting quirk that I have is I've noticed is that my mood depends on how I'm dressed. So if I'm dressed, you know, in baggy jeans and a jacket, then I suddenly start walking with a different kind of vibe and there's, I don't know, I feel kind of different. And when I'm wearing a salwar kameez, then I suddenly feel more feminine and I'm a little more soft-spoken. So I realized that theatre is just in my blood because this dramatics of costume and persona and roles is just part of my being and I can't help it. It's not something I'm trying to do, it's just the way it is.
My! I bought curtains, Vensi!
From where you bought this?
From Bazaar Road, man. I got 25% discount.
Arey Baba, you should have asked me, no? My fellow would have given you 40% discount.
We all have someone like that in our lives and I can totally relate to it. Okay, tell me, you have acted in many plays, you have anchored many glamorous events. What made you think of getting into comedy?
You know, I was always a very outgoing, outspoken, confident, free child. My mother used to call me Born Free and make me sing that song at all the competitions. Born Free. So I think I was always inhibitionless. And so very early in life, I was comfortable with being laughed at or people laughing with me. And there was always comedy in my house. My dad was always cracking really bad PJs and saying who can come up with the worst PJ. So I guess comedy was introduced to me through my dad, my uncles. And it was just part of the way we were. And then translated to when I, you know, interacted with my friends. I was very comfortable making a fool of myself and, you know, making faces and imitating people. And then, you know, you make more friends like that. And I think people used to just keep seeing the funny side of a lot of things that I would come up with my own words and things like that. But when I first went into writing my play, I didn't consciously write a comedy, he says, she says, but it just came out to be an out and out comedy. And then I remember the moment when I was standing in the wings and people started laughing at my punchlines and I was filled with this feeling I had never felt before. I had been on stage as an actor, but as a writer, to get people to respond to your content was just a feeling. It's one of the best feelings I've ever felt. And that was the day I realized, okay, I need to do more of this creation of content thing. And so I think it's a combination of both. It was always part of my life. And at the same time, it happened to me. So I drifted into it. And at the same time, I knew that comedy would somewhere always be part of my life in some capacity or the other. And Auntie Maggie had to be comedy. It just had to be the way she is. She can get away with saying so many things. Sometimes I just my own thoughts are pouring out through Auntie Maggie, and you know, in the litter episode she goes and throws the kachra back. These are all things we feel like doing in real life. We just want to, you know, go and shout at the guy who broke the signal and, you know, threw a can out of his car, and you just want to go and do something about it. Auntie Maggie does it, and that's why I think people really love her, because she gets away with doing all the things that occur to us, but things that we can never do because it's real life. But Auntie Maggie's on YouTube, so live vicariously through Auntie Maggie, and yeah, keep watching the videos, guys, and sharing it. See, I had to plug that in also.
Hey, gotta catch a play at NCPA.
Oh, wow.
We've got our logistics side. Bow a maca bow.
So we have our quirks.
Peaceful.
But we have our pride.
So you used comedy and music to make a strong point about the minorities getting their respect through that one. You have also shown a strong friendship with the Parsi uncle to remind people of communal harmony and true secularism. I have realized that yours is not a mindless comedy. There's always a message behind all your episodes.
I'm so glad that you said that, Maria. You know, as an artist, as a creator, as a writer, it just comes with the territory that we are observing and we have opinions, and then we want to translate those thoughts into our work. So if there's substance along with the comedy, then I'm clearly doing something right with the Auntie Maggie series. It wasn't always easy, though. In the case of the minorities video, I had just shot with Shahryar, okay, and he was so funny as Mr. Master, the Parsi character. And then I said, oh my God, I have to do another video with Shari because he's such a good singer as well. And then the idea just came to me that it's a Parsi and a Catholic, they're minorities. Then I went backwards, I found a tune, rewrote the lyrics, and it just fell into place. And the video was a riot. It's done really well with both communities. And it's a nice way to bring to light the fact that minorities contribute a lot to this country. And it's a funny song. And it also shows friendships, between two communities, and Auntie Maggie was all about that. One of her best friends was Omana Kutti, who was, always sharing recipes with her, and she has immense respect for her and love for her, and they have this very easy, effortless relationship. And that's what I wanted to say. It was not specifically one community and all about the Catholics. It was her nature to go out and make friends with everybody, and hopefully, again, another takeaway for the viewers. So, thanks. I'm happy that that's how it's being seen and received.
But it was kung fu fighting.
What?
What?
Those
hi-ya!
In fact, it was a little bit frightening.
This is just mad, and I laughed so much. Would you seriously recommend karate for senior citizens?
You know, at that time, there was a lot of chain snatching happening. And senior citizens were being targeted in and around this residential area of Bandra, and I just felt like I needed to put that out in an episode. And suddenly I thought self-defense, and then there was lots of comedy potential for Auntie Maggie to be doing karate moves. And then I remembered all the karate movies that I've watched, Karate Kid and you know all those, and I said, let's just use the song Kung Fu Fighting and let Auntie Maggie do all of that, and that whole Matrix thing she does and makes all those crazy hiya sounds. So I think the episode did really well. Not that I recommend karate for senior citizens unless they want to and they're really fit. But what I guess I was trying to say in that episode is, like Auntie Maggie, who's unafraid to do new things and just keep on changing, keep on moving. She's got this zest for life. I would want senior citizens to try their hand at line dancing, join a laughter club, keep living your best life.
We will celebrate every year to remember that special day. Anniversaries, men. It's our anniversary. That we remember every date and every time of every football game. But can't remember the beautiful, joyful union with a woman of his dreams.
That's such a typical scene. Most wives and girlfriends will definitely agree to it. Men often forget about romance like Silu. But I'm going to ask you a personal question now. I hope you don't mind. How is your husband like? Is he romantic? Does he help you with your shoots?
The truth of the matter is, I think part of Uncle Silu's character has been inspired by my own dear husband. At least the aspect which you asked me about, which is the gift-giving romantic side of the non-romantic side of Uncle Silu. And that is totally inspired by my husband, because he's not somebody who forgets to give gifts. He is somebody who doesn't believe in any grand gestures of romance, and he made that clear to me right in the beginning. And trust me, it took a lot of getting used to, because I love romance and I love the gestures, and you know, again, that whole dramatic side to me has to extend to my personal life. But I have to say that my husband is a very sorted, secure, you know, he's a sweet guy, and he finds other ways of making me feel special, and he will go out of his way to really help me when it really matters. And as I grew out of my desperate want for romance, I realized that, you know, this is his love language, and I need to start appreciating the way in which he is you know, making me feel special. But that didn't stop me from interpreting it and in my character for Silu, and it was a really cute dynamic, because you see Auntie Maggie just fighting with him about it and saying, you never come anywhere, and you're always saying no to everything. And so I guess I used the character Auntie Maggie to vent the way I couldn't vent in my real life. I don't know if I should even air this answer. Should we scratch it? This is going to be 40 days of you listening to your mother. What happened, Bosco? Where are you going? Doesn't matter. I'm coming up right behind you. I'll follow you. How many times I told you not to drive your bike fast? Huh? Never listen. Chup, I said. And I told you to go and stand inside the church. Do not stand outside mass. Shush! Why? I don't open up. Huh?
It's amazing how you brought out the mother-son relationship. From where did you get the inspiration from?
Yes, a very big part of the Auntie Maggie series was her relationship with her son. So she keeps mentioning Bosco throughout the series, even though I've never shown him. And I love that a lot of my viewers know everything about Bosco, even though I have never actually shown anything more than a shoulder and a hand. And something interesting, a little off topic, is that every time I shot, I used a different guy in the shot. So sometimes it was the shoulder of one of my friends, and then the hand of some other friend of mine. And so, you know, it was sometimes there were different shades of brown happening, and I was like, that's part of YouTube. But I love that the viewers love Bosco and her relationship. Yes, so I think I've observed, starting with my mom, my aunts, a lot of my friends' mums around, and you know, it would be really funny, especially when my friends had mothers who were very overbearing, you know. So it was very funny when they were mama's boys. So I thought that would be a very funny angle to put in the Auntie Maggie series, where she is like a helicopter mom. And so I have many episodes where Auntie Maggie is snooping on Bosco because she's heard that he's dating someone. Then she's after his blood because he rides his bike fast and doesn't wear a helmet. Many mothers can relate to this, and it's a nice way of slipping in that kind of you know, public service announcement to be safe on the roads, and many other things. He's her one precious son, and she has all her energies invested in him, and so she wants the best for him. So even when Millie comes along and she's trying to set him up with who she thinks would be the perfect girl for him, and there's this conflict of interest with Millie coming on the, you know, on the scene. So that whole track was very interesting, and I think a lot of the viewers relate and love it. Again, purely observation, what can I say?
All this YouTube and Google and this and that cannot help you, man. The best cooks in the world are the ones who know how to cook from here and from here. You don't need measuring cups and recipes and this and that. You have to know how to cook andaz, say, man, you know?
Andaz. Now that I know, andaz eggs.
Just see this one, man. Why, Sai Babu host, man.
I love watching Auntie Maggie and Millie together. What made you introduce this character?
You know, I was already about 100 episodes in, and I felt like the Auntie Maggie series needed a lift. I had teased and kind of, you know, played with the idea of Bosco and somebody and a girlfriend and him getting married and Auntie Maggie obsessing about when he's going to get married and give her grandchildren. So I said, let's try this. let's bring in a character. So I brought in the character Millie, and yes, Millie looks like, because I'm essentially didn't do anything from a styling point of view, but I wouldn't say that as a person she's the same. There was definitely a character there because I was going somewhere with that track, and I just wanted to bring out how Auntie Maggie had a vision in her mind regarding what her perfect daughter-in-law would be, and it would be somebody who dressed a certain way and could cook and all of these notions. And I wanted to show Millie, who is like also like Maggie in her genuinity. She wears what she wants, she admits that she doesn't know how to cook, she doesn't pretend to be something she's not, but she has a good heart. Her intent towards Bosco, her feelings towards Bosco are all in play. She means well, she's true and honest, and over time she grows on Maggie in spite of all these external aspects that would put Maggie off. She grows on Maggie, and that whole track was, I wanted to show how if you let people be and nobody feels the need to change, then the bond that happens between mother-in-law and daughter-in-law can be a real and lasting one. But it was not easy to shoot the double role of Auntie Maggie and Millie. Those episodes were really difficult because I had to first shoot always all the portions of Millie first, then keep in mind where Maggie would stand. Sometimes have my I would have people help me right with the shoots, and I would put the Maggie wig on them and then just shoot over the shoulder so it looks like Maggie's listening, but actually it's somebody else. And then I'd go and get into the Maggie outfit and then re-deliver the lines and then edit it. But I think it was quite cleverly done, even though it's been done on such a small scale. I don't have some big production unit behind me, but fun to play a double role, very difficult to execute the logistics of it, but I think it was totally worth it.
Yo, baile yo, tenenenene, solo makazai poelo, tenenenene, solo makadina zana tuzo, fotolo toklo.
All we Goans were very happy when we saw those three special episodes shot in Goa. Even the one with the Goan written girl has the highest number of views, I think, on your channel. So what we want to know is, since you stay in Mumbai, how aware are you of what's happening in Goa?
So I can't wait for the day that I can just move to Goa and make it my permanent home. I'm a Goan, so I think every time I come to Goa, I just feel at home. I feel at peace. I feel like this is where I belong, and it's just the best place on earth. Of course, I'm aware of what's happening in Goa. I think currently the Goans are most troubled by the fact that there's an influx of tourism. People are, just pouring into Goa. Goa was doing really well during this pandemic with almost zero cases. And now, unfortunately, the local Goans are getting affected, and I don't think it's fair to them. There's also, the whole protected forest areas that are being threatened right now at Mole. And I know that, that the locals are very passionately trying to save these wildlife sanctuaries and these areas. Right now, there's a whole railway track coming through just to transport coal. It seems like it's the agenda of a few, and I really don't know. I just feel like if the people at the center spend a little more time and think about this long and hard, I mean, we've got a beautiful haven that is our Goa, and I feel like there's always a solution if a little more thought and a little bit more consideration for the residents and the local people of Goa is considered, then we can find a way. So my love goes out to all my Goan fans, who watch Auntie Maggie regularly and have shown me so much love. I got a couple of articles written about me right in the beginning when I had done hardly 10 episodes. So all of the support and love means a lot to me, and hopefully I will be there really soon and just settle down with a nice glass of Fainey in my hand.
And now I got a hairline fracture, Joe.
But that is nothing, Ray. 1 year ago, no? I was driving my Lambretta, and this SUV coming from the wrong side, he comes and bang me. I had a hip fracture.
You're so beautiful. Tell us, how does it feel when you have to make yourself look old and fair?
Thanks, Maria, for all those kind and sweet compliments. I really appreciate it. How do I feel getting in the costume? Look, it's a role, right? It's a character that I've created. So now it's my job to commit 100% to bringing that character alive. And the truth of the matter is that I enjoyed getting into the Auntie Maggie costume. So it's a big fat suit. And while it was very hot and uncomfortable, it gave me the opportunity to move a certain way, walk a certain way. Like, I enjoyed jiggling the belly, and a really funny thing is that I've used the costume for so long that the costume has started to give way. So now what was supposed to be Auntie Maggie's bosom and her buttocks has now reached the back of my knees and you know, my belly, and it's, I have to keep pulling it up between shots. So if you see the behind the scenes, it's actually quite hilarious. Anyone around is always like, oh my god, what is happening here, because it's so inappropriate the way I keep doing that. But I have no time, I have to keep getting on with the shot. So yeah, it's hot, but I enjoy it because it's crazy. And you know, one of the things that I love about Auntie Maggie as a character is that she doesn't care how she looks. She just owns the world. That's how she carries herself. And I think if my viewers have to take anything home, it would be that. Own your space, own your life, and nobody else's opinion about you and your choices or how you look should ever matter. So that's how it is. If they're loving my portrayal of Auntie Maggie and they're enjoying her endearing quirks, then that's the ultimate compliment for me.
Tu kya karta hai?
Ye aap idhar mat dekho.
Tu public mein susu karta hai aur bolta hai idhar mat dekh. Aisa logic hai kya?
What plans do you have for the series Auntie Maggie? What can your fans expect?
Okay, so immediate plans for the future would be to continue the Auntie Maggie live sessions, which I do on Instagram, YouTube, and Facebook. I did it for 2 months, and it's a really great way to engage with all the Auntie Maggie viewers. So we play games, and I come up with funny games like Distat and all that. And then I came up with Sing Men Simon. So all these funny games which involve guessing songs and things like that, and the viewers are so fun. They crack their own jokes and add to the whole ambience on that live chat. So it goes on for 1 hour and I can answer them real time. They say something and I can comment and I'm like, who said that? And it's a lot of fun. So I'm going to do that again in December, and I have prizes to give out this time. So I think that everyone should join my live sessions, 8 o'clock on Monday. And in the future, I mean, there's so much I could do with the show. I could really blow it up and do it in a bigger way, but I need definitely, if someone wants to start a crowdfunding you know, channel for me to get some kind of monetary returns from all the effort. Time is money, and I put in so much effort that I need there to be some kind of return. While I've been loving, you know, loving and living on all the love and appreciation and the messages that I get from my viewers, really is the soul that keeps me going. Going forward, if I have to take it bigger, I would definitely need more, some kind of sponsorship, some kind of, you know, somebody funding me from the back, and then I can do wonders with the show, you know, come up with fun merchandise, and you know, there's lots of potential for Auntie Maggie. If people really love it, they should make it happen for me. What do you say? Otherwise, this one-man show, whew, it can get exhausting.
Thanks a lot, Rosalind, for this interview. And thank you one more time for showing such keen interest in this interview and contributing to it to make it, you know, more interesting. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Because before you leave, there's something you have to do.
Absolutely. Guys, please like, share, comment, and subscribe to Maria's My Goa, My India channel. She's going to be doing a lot more fun interviews like this one. And so show her some love and support. Also, please go to my channel, Raw City, and watch the Auntie Maggie videos. There's over 200 of them. If you haven't seen them already, and if you have, there's always a rewatch. So refresh your mind, and it's definitely got rewatch potential, I think. So guys, go watch it, and thank you so much for taking the time out to watch this interview. It means a lot. Mwah.